Hi, everyone. I'm Frank Malakota. I'm a news anchor, reporter for KTVU, Fox 2 here in the San Francisco Bay Area. I'm talking to a clinical psychologist today. She is also the brand ambassador to Custodio, a leader in digital safety and well-being for kids and family alike. Let's say hi to Dr. Nicole Berkins. How are you?
Hey, I'm great. Thanks for having me.
My guess is you have been busy. Our COVID world has just changed everything, and especially when it comes to screen time, because here we are on Zoom, chit-chatting away, and I know kids are being homeschooled and parents are working from home on screens and whatnot, and although that's wonderful, there are some concerns out there as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the upside of all the technology that we have now, especially with this pandemic going on, is that kids are able to stay connected socially to friends, to activities. They're able to continue their education, which is a big one, able to be exposed to new learning and new opportunities. So certainly there's great benefit that devices and digital media bring to our life. But as you said, it's important to be aware of the potential negatives as well, because the research is really clear that excessive use of digital media and of electronic devices can have some pretty significant negative consequences for kids physically, in terms of being overly sedentary, tendency towards obesity, some of those kinds of things, even physical vision kinds of issues. Wow. And also in the mental health realm, we know that excessive use can lead to worse attention and focus, more hyperactivity, behavior problems. And as kids start getting into those preteen and teen years, more likelihood of things like anxiety, depression, some of those kinds of things. So we want to celebrate the benefits and embrace those and make use of that, especially during this time, but also work on finding balance so we don't have those negative issues come up.
All right. I went and found out my screen time yesterday on my iPhone. 6 hours. I mean, that's crazy, but I'm doing a lot for work, going back and forth and that kind of thing. I just discovered that maybe about a year ago. I didn't even know it was on there, and I look at it weekly. And I think it will blow your mind when you realize that you are so attached to these devices. Mm-hmm. It's kind of crazy.
Well, and first of all, I'll say 6 hours, you're like, you get a gold star compared to most people. People are looking at that now as adults and going, oh my gosh, I, you know, had 17 hours of screen time.
Oh,
which
my God.
With working constantly now, I mean, you know, these numbers are increasing, and we know, you know, Custodio has gathered some data since the pandemic and the sheltering in place started, even over in Europe now a couple months ago. And we're seeing, for kids and adults alike, device use is easily doubling, you know, as a result of all of this. But what you bring up is an excellent point about awareness. Very often, we are not really aware of the amount of time that we're spending on devices and how that time adds up. It's like, well, just a little here, a little there. And suddenly you look at it at the end of the day and you're like, oh my gosh, my kids spent, you know, 8 hours on this. So that awareness piece is huge. And, you know, whether it's using the screen time features that come on devices, and they almost all of them have that now, where you can go in and see, or some of them even send you notifications, or it's using an app like Custodio that you can sit down with kids and look at the data, not as a punishment, but to just become more aware. Right. Wow, how much time do you think you spent on video games or on Instagram or, you know, just online in general today? Let's take a look at that and let's see, do we feel good about that? Do we feel like there's some room for improvement? And by looking at that and building awareness, we really help kids to start to develop healthier digital habits, which is what we want, because the world does revolve around technology and we want them to grow up to be adults who have a healthy relationship with technology. So that awareness is a really important piece.
And I think it breaks it down into apps. You were on Facebook an hour and a half. And this, I mean, I was astonished. Usually I'm a good 3 hour guy, but six hours, I went, oh my gosh, I'm embarrassed. I didn't get a gold star. So that's not
you get a gold star from me. That's right.
Well, doctor, tell us about Custodio. Out of the gate, I should have asked you about that, but I know you're the brand ambassador for that. Yeah. Tell us what you folks do.
So Custodio is an app that parents can use and put on devices for themselves, but, you know, particularly for children, to help monitor and manage device use. So it goes above and beyond a lot of the features that come with parent controls on devices, and it allows parents to not only set time limits on devices, but also on specific uses of devices, so specific apps, specific categories of things. It monitors all that. It also has safety features to help monitor for the types of content that kids can access. It can flag certain things, make parents aware if there's concerns there. And so the way I look at these types of apps, and I use Custodio both myself as a parent of four kids, as well as recommending it at my clinic, because awareness is what we want. We want parents and kids to be partnering together to look at device use, to look at and talk about what's safe, what's potentially unsafe, what's healthy versus not healthy. And having an app like Custodio allows for that good ongoing communication that we then start to give kids more leeway as they get older to start to look at making more of those decisions for themselves so that they can develop those healthy habits as they grow up.
How do your kids react to the app? I mean, young and old.
Yeah, so my kids are eighth grade through high school now, and this has just been a fact of life for them since they started using devices. It's a requirement for us as parents that if you're going to be using devices, we're going to have some limits for safety as well as for health, and it really has helped them develop positive habits. Now, do they like it all the time? No. But I always tell parents, if your child is happy with you 100% of the time, there's something wrong there. As parents, we need to be setting limits on things. And just as we set limits on other things in our kids' lives for the sake of their health and for their safety, we need to be looking at that in the digital world as well. And it's a challenge because the generation of parents raising kids right now, we are the first generation of parents raising kids in a 24/7 connected culture. We didn't grow up with this. We can't look to our parents or our grandparents to say, oh, how did they manage, you know, device use with kids? It wasn't a factor. So we're trying to figure this out as we go along. And I think that, you know, building this awareness of things that we need to be thinking about and having apps like this that make it easier to manage and to monitor and have conversations with kids. You know, I'm all about tools that make our lives easier as parents.
Sure. Well, what do you say to your kid that comes up, Mom, I mean, you know, I haven't seen my friends for weeks, if not months, you know, I'm homeschooling. Mm-hmm. I need a little more time. Do they broker that a little bit? And, and maybe you can also talk about the fact that these kids are, you know, they're in isolation, and so much about growing up is having that peer group that you can touch and go play with, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, during this time of sheltering in place, being out of school, kids are feeling isolated more than ever before. And they are missing the face-to-face, in-person connections. And so I'm really encouraging parents to have flexibility around device use at this point. It's totally normal and even appropriate for kids to be spending more time online right now, as long as they're doing quality things, you know, keeping up with their schooling, doing some leisure things that they enjoy, connecting with their friends. And that's one of the things we're seeing in the data too. You know, Custodio collected the data that showed that while use is up significantly among kids, a lot of that use falls in the category of educational platforms and staying socially connected with peers. Right. So that's the good news. That's the quality piece. And right now we want to be emphasizing in a lot of ways, quality, even maybe more than quantity. So not getting on ourselves as parents and saying, oh my gosh, my kid has spent way more time than I normally would allow, but looking at, are they using that time for good purpose? And certainly staying socially connected is important. So being flexible around that and being willing to have some discussion and saying, yes, you can have more time because I want you to be able to talk with your soccer team and coach or hang out with your friends on, you know, FaceTime or whatever it might be. So that flexibility and understanding that there is going to be an appropriate use for having more time right now, but also being mindful of creating balance and making sure that kids aren't spending all of their time on devices, that they're having other things they're doing as well.
Imbalance is key for sure. Yeah. How about, do you have times where you just say, all right, we're in a no iPad, no iPhone, no video game mode. It's about family right now. It's, you know, we're going to take a walk, take a hike, and get the kids out just to be human and kind of find their roots, so to speak.
Absolutely. Having periods of time as a family where you're all disconnected from your devices and plugging into each other and your relationships is really key. And that's true across the board, pandemic or not. That's a great way of instilling and modeling that balance. I'm a big proponent of device-free dinner, device-free meals, where we all come to the table together and no one has their device. And that means mom and dad too. Right? Because we can tell kids all day long what we think they should be doing, but what do they most often take as the most meaningful thing? What they see us doing. So if we are modeling things like putting our devices away to come to meals, then they're going to fall in line with that. If we're modeling closing the computer, leaving the phone at home, and going out as a family to walk the dog, that's a powerful model for them of there are important things that happen from leaving the devices alone and just connecting with each other and having that time off screen. Again, for physical health and mental health and relational health, that's a really important thing.
I bet. Well, let's practice what you preach. If you're telling your kids, don't do that, and you're sitting here going, yeah, about that golf game. All right. Yeah.
That's exactly right. And kids pick up on that and they know, you know, oh, you know, mom, you said you'd play this game with me and we're playing the game, but you're texting with somebody and, oh, you've got your ear out for, you know, notifications on your computer. You're not really here with me. And I think that that's important for parents to recognize that kids pick up on that. And we show them what we really value and what's really important in terms of our willingness to, again, at times when it's appropriate, to put our attention on them, to say whatever's going on Facebook or with my job or on the phone right now, that's not the most important thing. I'm going to shut that down and pay attention to you. That's a really powerful way of modeling healthy device habits and healthy relational habits for our kids.
Are you worried that some kids that are doing, you know, a lot of screen time are going to develop bad habits, assuming that this all goes away, COVID-19, they'll take those into to other parts of their world, so to speak?
Yeah, I think there is a concern for kids right now who really are spending the vast majority of their waking hours on devices. There's a concern that those habits can be hard to break when life goes back to normal. Some kids will say, oh, this is great. I can go back to normal things and say, great, I don't want to be on the devices all the time anymore. But some kids we know, their brains tend to be just more powerfully impacted by the digital stimulation, by the time on devices. And so for some of those kids, it can be a challenge then to undo some of that and to get back to engaging and doing real life things. And, you know, parents tend to know if their kid is a kid who struggles with that. And that's important to be aware of even more for those kids to say, we need to find some balance here. Yes, you can spend time on devices, but we also need to be making sure during this time that you have some things that you're doing that are off devices so you stay used to doing those things and are able then to transition back into normal life, in-person kinds of activities when that happens.
What is it about our phones, our tablets? It's almost like a narcotic. There's an addiction there. I don't know. You would know more than me with the brain, but, you know, I've been in my car where you get a text and the phone's over there and it's like, well, I want to know what's going on, you know? And But you might get in a car wreck if you read it.
Right.
What is that?
Well, you're absolutely right that there is an addictive quality. These devices, and not only the devices themselves, but the apps and the things that we do on them are designed to capitalize on that dopamine response system in our brain. We get that hit of dopamine, that neurochemical that makes us feel so good. It's that reward center of our brain, not unlike what we experience with, you know, when we win at a soccer game or when we, you know, eat that donut that we really love or, you know, any of those kinds of things. You get this hit of this feel-good dopamine chemical in your brain and it is addictive. We want more of that. And these apps and these programs and these devices are all geared towards creating that dopamine cycle and that response in our brain. So they really are addictive. And I think all of us as adults can attest to that, right? Exactly the example that you just gave of, you know, that notification goes off and immediately that part of our brain lights up and it's like, oh, I want that pleasure seeking, that I need to see what that is, or I have a fear of missing out, or whatever it may be. So that is a powerful neurological mechanism that's going on. And particularly, we see that some people's brains are more predisposed to being sensitive to that and falling into that addictive pattern, that craving of that dopamine hit more quickly. And for some children too, and parents sort of know inherently if their kid is one of those kids, because these are the kids even from an early age that even after, you know, a relatively brief amount of time on their device have a really hard time pulling away, right? Mm-hmm. Mom or dad says, okay, time to turn that off now. And they really are kind of flipping out about it. Or these kids who are constantly seeking, you know, to be on devices. So you can kind of see those patterns early on. And that's where it is important for parents to notice those things and to be intentional about helping kids learn to regulate that better and to have other interests and other things that they're doing so that we aren't constantly having them in that cycle of craving that and seeking that out.
I know there was an article I read about casinos.
Yeah.
Everything is geared in there to put you right in this world, from the carpet to the mm-hmm. smells to the sounds, and of course alcohol and winning money and all that kind of stuff. What they're doing, no windows, everything they can to keep you connected. And I imagine all the apps are doing the same. We want you, the more you play, the more we make. And
that's exactly right. It's the perfect example. And that is exactly what's going on, which is why, you know, we read about the people who work in Silicon Valley in the industries who create these things. They are aware of the risks because they know they're involved in designing these things to create these addictive behaviors, these, you know, tendencies towards that. And they will say, well, I don't let my kid use those things, right? Because they know how powerful it is because they're designing it and they're using all of those principles of neurochemistry, of psychology, of all of that to go into these. So we need to be savvy as consumers, particularly as parents, to say, okay, given that that's how these things are created, how can we help our kids develop a healthy relationship and not fall into that trap?
I know you're a nutritionist as well. It's important. I mean, I was talking to a life coach prior to you, and I do 3 or 4 of these a day, and you get involved, and all of a sudden it's 3 o'clock, and I go, oh, I forgot to eat.
Uh-huh.
You know? I imagine kids are going through some of that as well as they're being homeschooled and, you know, talking to their friends and kind of getting out of the rhythm of the day of going to school. So that's an important part of it as well, for parents as well.
Absolutely. Nutrition makes such a difference for how we feel and how we function. And so when we are out of routines and forgetting to eat, or, you know, having our eating be off schedule or eating different things than we normally do, that definitely has an impact on not only our physical health, but also our brain health. And especially for children, they are more sensitive to blood sugar fluctuations throughout the day, which is why we know, you know, kids, boy, when they need to eat, because if they get too hungry, we've got a meltdown going on, right? It just all, you know, is not good. And we're sensitive to that as adults too, but kids are even more sensitive. And so it's important to have some basic routines established, even during this time of things being obviously very different than they were prior, still keeping basic routines of waking up at an appropriate time, going to bed at an appropriate time, and eating throughout the day, the breakfast, the lunch, the dinner, you know, snacks for young kids, not overdoing it, not just going to one extreme and saying we just sort of eat all day long, because that's not good either. Of course, when we're doing that, we're not eating celery sticks and, you know, whole grains and things that are good for our kids' brains and bodies. So we don't want to go to that extreme, but we also want to make sure that we're not just eating when we realize that, oh my gosh, I haven't eaten in all these hours and now I have a headache and I'm grumpy, or my kid's melting down, oh, better, you know, feed them. We want to keep some of those routines, and that structure in that routine is not only helpful for them from a nutritional standpoint, but also just from an anxiety standpoint and just a functional standpoint of knowing, you know, some predictable patterns throughout the day. That's a really important thing for children.
I know you touched on this a little bit, but I think it bears repeating, some of the byproducts of too much screen time again. And what are those?
Yeah. So the research shows pretty clearly at this point for babies all the way through young adults that excessive use, overuse of digital media and electronic devices has negative consequences for physical and mental health. So on the physical health side of things, some of the most common concerns of overuse of screen time are things like being sedentary, not moving enough. And so then we have unhealthy weight gain. We can also have problems of, you know, young kids not developing the motor coordination that they need to because they're not up and moving and being physical enough. And the eye piece of it, the vision development piece of it, kids are now needing reading glasses at earlier and earlier ages. And a big factor in that is that they're using devices so close to their eyes, whereas most, you know, in normal development, young children are out in the world using their distance vision more. So those are some of the physical pieces. From a mental health side, what the research shows is that in young children, so birth to five, when they are overusing screens and digital media, they can have cognitive delays, communication delays, issues in how they are learning how to relate to the people around them. And then as they get into the elementary and middle school years, we can see problems with attention and focus, hyperactivity, impulsivity, moodiness, and behavior challenges. And as we get into those teen and young adult years, we start to see fallout in the way of significant anxiety problems, depression problems, even suicidality. So there are consequences at every age and stage of development when kids are overusing these devices.
Well, it bears repeating, and certainly mom and dad can corral their kids and themselves in that regard. I always ask people that I interview about your region. You live in Michigan. Yep. I know there was a hot spot there weeks back. Tell us how people are, how are they doing in Michigan right now, and are they taking everything seriously? What's it like?
Yeah, in Michigan, so for a while there, we were the number three state behind New York and New Jersey with the number of cases and the number of deaths. I think statewide, we've done a good job of working to contain that. Certainly, Detroit was hit very hard for several weeks with a lot of cases of COVID-19, a lot of deaths, unfortunately. On this side of the state, the west side of the state where I am, not as much. But what I'm seeing, and I work with patients throughout the state, people are taking this seriously. People are using good common sense about, you know, staying at home, about, you know, hygiene, hand washing. Now we're required to wear masks when we're out in, you know, populated public kinds of places. Things are starting to open up. Schools are closed for the rest of the year, so everybody is adjusting to that and not going back to, you know, normal with that until hopefully the fall. But I think things are improving in Michigan for sure, and I think what all of us have been willing to do on a personal level as well as a statewide level has really helped contain that, and hopefully we're going to keep moving in the right direction.
Well, let's hope so. Let's hope so. So if someone wants to get in touch with you, doctor, or with Custodial, how do they do it?
Yeah, so my website is drberkins.com, and I've got lots of resources there for parents around the things we've been talking about today, screen time, development, nutrition, parenting, all of that. And custodio.com is where they can go to learn more about the Custodio app and get lots more information about screen time and digital wellness and all of those kinds of things.
And Custodio is Q-U-S-T-O-D-I-O, right?
Correct. Yes.
Okay. Well, doctor, thank you very much. Really appreciate your insight, and all the best with your four kids, and stay well.
Thank you. You as well.
All right. I'm Frank Malico with Fox here in the San Francisco Bay Area. Remember, you can always go to coronavirusnow.com if you'd like more information. Have a good day.